Good morning and welcome to Calvary Chapel this morning. Those of you who braved the weather. Let's pray. Father, again, as we come to this place and to worship you this morning, to get to know you better, Lord, we pray that even now you would search our hearts and see if anything, Lord, would separate us from you. And we know by your blood, Jesus, we are forgiven. And that you came out of that grave, Lord, that you're alive today and you live in our hearts as we surrendered our lives to you and believed in you, Lord. So be exalted in this place today. Have your way in each heart. Change and make us more like you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we're going to do some songs for the kids first. So kids, you got to stand up. Miss Anna has the motions.
Stand
I know
up.
Some of you are new.
Let's all stand up.
Kids, let's stand up. Come on. Get up,
get up,
get up, get up, get up, get up, get up, get up,
get up. Older kids, we're all God's kids, right?
Older kids, yeah.
Come on.
He's got the whole
jump out of the dark, dark, dark. Run to Jesus and give him your jump, jump out of the dark, dark, dark. Run to Jesus and give him your heart.
Okay? And then, is there motions to this, Miss Sam?
Just when we want.
And then when we say papaya, after we say papaya, we want you to scream real loud, papaya. Okay, we'll show you how it goes, okay? Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Wait. There's only a couple of us counting. Let's try it again.
Count loud.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I love the bananas. I know that bananas are sweet. Listen, some of you, you know, go to churches and they always tell you to be quiet, right? I'm telling you to be loud. So I want to hear papaya, okay? Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I love bananas. I know that bananas. Earbuds in my ear. Let's try that again. Sorry, Jeff. just hold your ears and you'll be okay. I want to hear papaya, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I like bananas. I know that bananas are sweet. I like papaya. Papaya! Nothing can be the sweet. The world seems so sweet and it turns so sour. And when I turn around, I receive his power. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I know that animals are sure. I love papaya. And nothing can be the sweet. Going in circles. I was walking round in circles for about miles per hour. Trying to find my way back. So sour. And when I turned around, I received his power.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
I know that mangoes are sweet. I love papaya. Nothing can be the sweet. One last time, here we go. I love bananas. I know that mangoes are sweet. I love Jesus loves me. going to follow Miss Anna out to Sunday school. She has a special thing for you. She used me for a model, okay? Levity never. Go ahead and out, Miss Anna. You'll have fun, I guarantee you. If you don't go there, you have to listen to me and I may bore you to death. For Lord, you are so worthy to receive all glory, all honor, all power. We turn our hearts towards you, Jesus. Thank you.
Jesus, Lord, Emmanuel, God is with us, blessed Redeemer, living Word.
Jesus, your name is wonderful. You have the name above all names. You are the Lord above all lords. And one day, Lord, every knee will bow before you that has ever existed, every knee, Lord. What a day that will be. Oh, Lord, we thank you that you are here with us this morning. And now we ask, Holy Spirit, minister the word of God into our hearts and into our lives, every way in each one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. This morning, if you'd like to follow along, Mr. Christian has a Bible here. You can just raise your hand if you want to follow along with. We are in the book of James this morning, chapter 2. Teenagers, you can go out with Mr. Kerwin. 12 and older, I guess 12 is not a teenager yet, is it? Although 12-year-olds think they're teenagers sometimes. Mr. Delano's not with us this morning, so I guess I have to remember the announcements. I know there's not too many of them. You know that we're not meeting on Sunday nights right now or Tuesday mornings. Miss Jackie will be back next week. And I think she's going to start up her Tuesday morning women's study again, I think. But we'll see if that happens. The next two Sundays, Mr. Kerwin will be teaching the Word. Miss Ann and I are going to get away for a little vacation, which we haven't had in 3 years. So we're going to, since before COVID, so we're going to go see Anna's brother and then spend a couple days in Mexico eating tacos at our favorite place there. Hope it's still there. And we're going to put it online, but we'll be under Kerwin's page, so it'll be live online under Kerwin Ramirez. So you can tune in for that. We do have our study this Wednesday night. We started the book of Exodus last week, and this week we'll be in chapter 3 of Exodus. So, James chapter 2 this morning. The book of James, the book of, as a Christian, the rubber meets the road, man. How to live as a Christian, how to show the world that we follow Jesus. So last chapter, we were looking at being doers of the word and not just hearers of the word. Applying the things in God's word to our life and not just going to church and listening and or reading the Bible and that's enough, but putting it into our lives, walking it out in our lives. So we show the gospel in our lives. Do as I do, not as I say. A lot of times we, you know, especially as parents sometimes, do as I say, not as I do. You have to be careful of that. We looked at watch what you say, which was last week, the tongue, setting things on fire, destroying people's reputations. Venom like a poisonous snake, it says in the Bible, the tongue is. And it talked about taking care of the orphans and the widows and keeping yourself pure before the Lord. Set apart from the world. We're to love one another with an agape love, an unconditional love, with no trips and no conditions. Just plain old loving someone, no matter who they are. It's hard to do sometimes, but you know what? With the Lord's strength and the Lord in us, we can do that. You know, Peter in Acts chapter 10, he was called to minister to the Gentiles, and to him that was like, they were dogs. The Jews did not like Gentiles. They were rubbish, garbage. And God called him to minister to the Gentiles. Those of you who don't know that, we are Gentiles, unless you're Jewish. They wanted nothing to do with us, but God told him to, and he shared with them
Guess what? And they got saved. God did not look at them. We're ringing here. I'm in awe how the sound system can change from week to week, you know, the humidity in the air and stuff like that. So God did not look at the Gentiles with, like the Jews were better. There was no partiality with them. They were loved by God the same as he loved the Jews. Just like he loves all of us the same. Saved or not saved, he loves everyone. You know, Peter said this in Acts 10, verse 34 and 35. He's opening his mouth. Peter said, I most certainly understand now that God is not one to show partiality. But in every nation, the man who fears him and does what is right is welcome to him. So God did not make a difference between Jews and Gentiles, men or women, slaves and freemen, black or white, rich or poor. There's no difference in God's eyes. He loves all the same. So that brings us to verse 1 of James chapter 2. He says this, my brethren, do not hold your faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ with an attitude of personal favoritism. Don't look at people like one is better than another. Well, that person's more handsome than that person. I like them more, you know. We're not to do that. Or that one dresses better than this one. We're not to do that. So he continues on there in verse 2 and says, for if a man comes into your assembly, excuse me, with a gold ring and dressed in fine clothes, and there also comes in a poor man in dirty clothes, and you pay special attention to the one who is wearing the fine clothes and say, you sit here in a good place. And you say to the poor man, you stand over there or you sit down by my footstool. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil motives? Listen, my beloved brethren. Did not God choose the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. It is not the rich who oppress you and personally drag you into court. Do they not blaspheme the fair name by which you have been called? Don't do that. Don't look at one person that is rich and treat them better than you do who someone is poor. Love the unlovely. But you know what? You love the rich people too. Because sometimes we go in the opposite direction and we won't treat them right. You see, when we do that, when we think, look at one and treat one better than another, we're making a judgment that one person is better than another. And that's not our job. That's not what we are to do in this world. Maybe we want something from them, so we treat them better. It happens in churches a lot. That's why, you know, most pastors I know in the States, you know, they really don't want to know who's giving what. Because, you know, that way they don't have to deal with it, which is wisdom. My pastor, through the years, told this story. I heard it a few times from him. Story of a woman who was poor. And she went to this church. It was a very, very wealthy, wealthy church. And the people noticed she was poor. The pastor noticed she was poor. And, you know, they really didn't want her. But, you know, they can't act like that. So, you know, the pastor went to her and says, well, you know, you should go home and really think about coming to our church. Is this, you know, where God really wants you to be? She came back the next week. And that week as she left, he said, well, you know, this should go really pray about it. And she came back the following week and he said, well, go seek God and seek God's wisdom on whether you're really supposed to be here or not. And she didn't come back. And then 6 months later, he was at a store and she was at this store and he saw her and he says, well, what happened? She said, well, you know, I sought God and Jesus spoke to me. He said, don't worry about it. I've been trying to get in that church for 20 years and they don't let me in either. Early 1980s, some of you weren't around then. Miss Ann and I started this Christian rock, new wave, what's called new wave music back then, you know. Boop, beauty, boop, you know. This rock group. And we were pretty good. We were a good group. But not everybody would receive us. I mean, I wore, you know, space clothes and stuff. I like rock, you know, rock stars did, you know, acted the part, whatever. And we went to this camp one time. I'm not going to tell the denomination of this camp. And we went there. We just wanted to share Jesus, man. We just wanted to love on the kids there. And they kicked us out of camp because of our music. That's not godly music. That can't be godly music. The drums and stuff like that, you know, can't be godly music. And I'll never forget what I said. When I was a young Christian, you know, I probably didn't have a lot, you know, do things really right or something. I remember as we're packing up and looking at the leaders and as they're watching us pack up, and I looked at them and said, "So you're kicking Jesus out of camp?" And we left. Probably shouldn't have said that, but that's what I felt like. They were kicking Jesus out of camp. We had to take our music to the byways and the highways. We had to go to fairs, you know. We went to prisons, you know. We went to bars and played our music and stuff because the church didn't want us. When Ann and I were younger, we were hippies, and some of you new folks don't know that. But we were hippies, and there was no churches that really welcomed us in. And we tried. I just wanted to know Jesus. I went to jail for a little time there. I gave my life to the Lord. I brought my wife to the Lord. And so, but the church wouldn't let us in. If any of you have seen the Jesus Revolution, that was us. That was us. And when they sat down and Lonnie Frisbee talked to Pastor Chuck, and he said, Pastor Chuck, so what about your people? What about your people? And Lonnie says to him, "Pastor Chuck, your doors are not open to my people." And that was us, the hippies. They thought we were scum, that we were nothing, that we were dirty, that we were poor. And Pastor Chuck opened the doors. He let us in. And my goodness, he went, in within a six-month period, he went from, you know, maybe 25, 30 people in his church to 2,000 people. Because we wanted to know who God was. And nobody would share the Lord with us. And he did. And we just ate it up. Because, you know, as hippies, we were doing drugs. All the things we were doing, you know what? We were seeking God. We were looking for God. And God says, "You seek me, you will find me." And God was faithful to change Pastor Chuck's heart to let us in. Even years later, in 1989, when Ann and I started our band, Truckee Graphite, and started traveling, you know, the states and going through the world and playing our music, we were not accepted in most of the denominational churches because the music that we did was too rocky for them. And man, you know what? We just wanted to share Jesus with people. But eventually things changed and we got accepted. I'll never forget when we got it. The most amazing thing to me was back in those days, the Baptist churches were pretty straight, you know. And we were a Calvary Chapel, you know, and this is how we dressed, okay? In the Baptist church, you wore a suit and a tie. I mean, we were opposite. But the Baptist church brought us in and accepted us. And that was really a blessing. We watched them change through the years. It was a real blessing. So, back to James chapter 2, verse 8. 8 and 9. These two verses I'm going to focus pretty much the rest of the time on. If however you are fulfilling the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. We do not help the rich man at all by treating him better, because he's not better. He's not even richer in God's kingdom. It's a sin. It's a sin to treat a rich man better than a poor man. And if you're showing partiality, you're not serving the Lord, or you're not walking with the Lord if you do that. We dishonor others when we put people in front of other people. So he gives us the key here in verse 8. He says, love others. The royal law. Love others. President in the late 1800s, William McKinley, he was an upright man. He was a good man. But when he was younger and he was running for Congress, there was a young reporter that tried to destroy him. Tried to ruin him. Anything he said, he would twist it around. He would make him sound like he was, you know, not right. You know, like politicians still do today, right? It still happens. Just try to destroy him. Well, one night when McKinley was going to speak at a place where he was running for Congress, he heard someone outside of his carriage hacking and coughing. Somebody was really sick outside his carriage. It was raining. He said, "Come in here." It was that young reporter. And when the young reporter saw who it was, he says, "Oh no, you don't want me. Look what I've done to you." And McKinley said, "You come in here." And he took care of him. Even though the way he was treated, he took care of him. He would have called him his enemy. And the Lord says, love your enemies. Take care of them. The Good Samaritan. Samaritans were another people that the Jews hated because they were not all Jewish. Half and half. So the Jews didn't like them. They wanted nothing to do with them. And so Jesus gave this parable one time to his disciples and to those around him. It's in Luke chapter 10. If you want to turn there, you can. Luke chapter 10, verse 29, he says, "But he, wanting to justify himself, asked Jesus, 'So who is my neighbor?'" Because, you know, the Lord's saying, you need to love your neighbor. And the guy says, "Well, who is my neighbor?" Then Jesus answered and said, "A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead." In other words, they beat him up, man. They took his clothes, and they left him to die on the side of the road. Now by chance, a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Can you just see him? The priest is walking down the road, and he sees this guy hurt, cuts across the street and walks so he didn't have to deal with him. Likewise, a Levite. You know, Levite, they were supposed to be an upright tribe. A Levite, when he arrived at that place, came and looked and passed on the other side also. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. He set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and he took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, "Take care of him, and whatever more you spend when I come again, I will repay you." So which of these 3 do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And he said, "He who showed mercy on him." Then Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." Love the unlovely. Minister to those that nobody else wants anything to do with. That's God's way. The royal law. The royal law. That's, you know, that's preeminent. That's the law that we need to follow. John 15:12, Jesus said, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends." The only commandment Jesus gave us. Love one another. 1 John 4:7-11. "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another." When you think of love, you know, in the worldly sense of love, you know, we look at it in different ways. We look at it like in feelings. We look at it in the in the physical sense. But you know what? Love is action. You know, when you read 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 through 7, it talks about what love is. And not one word in there is about feeling. It's all action. So how do you love your enemy? Because, you know, you don't even like your enemy. You probably, maybe you do. I have enemies I love. I have enemies I like that don't like me. Then I have enemies that I don't like, but I love. Well, that sounds weird. Well, you know what? I don't have to like you to love you. I can treat you nice. I can pray for you. I can do things for you and love you. Now, it's nice if you like them too, but it hasn't got anything to do with feelings. It has to do with action in your life. And one way that you can love people that are your enemies is by praying for them. You know, through all my years of living in the States, there have been presidents I liked. There have been presidents I don't like. But ever since I've been a Christian, I pray for both ones I like and ones I don't like. Because my Bible tells me I should. My Bible doesn't tell me I should put them down and tear them up and say how rotten they are and how stinking they are and how, you know, how they're ruining everything. My Bible doesn't say to do that. It says, pray for them. Pray for your leaders. So I pray they get saved. It'd be nothing like having a real, true, walking Christian as the president or the prime minister, one who really knew the Lord, that did not compromise his walk. That would be tremendous. You say, but it's hard to love your enemy. You know what? It is hard, but you have the love of God living in you. The Holy Spirit lives in you, and he can love that person through you. You let him do it. There's been many times I've just had to love somebody, just let Jesus love them through me. Because I didn't feel like it. I didn't want to. The Holy Spirit in us, loving through us. It's a spiritual thing. I can't explain it to you, really. You just have to experience it. Let Jesus love people through you. When you do that, you can love them more than you can on your own. Those of you who are married, let Jesus love your spouse through you. You'll have more love for him or her than you do on your own. Guaranteed. It's supernatural, spiritual in nature. So how do you love your enemy? You know, Jesus said in Matthew 5, verse 38, he said, you have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evil person. But whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also. And that's hard. Have you ever done that? It's hard. You know, in a sense, it doesn't mean just the whap slap, but doing something to you, and you just go ahead and let him do it. And you want that? Well, he continues on. He says, if anyone wants to sue you, take your shirt, let him have your coat also. That's the slap, and there it is, turning the other cheek, giving him the cloak also. Or, whoever forces you to go 1 mile, go with him too. I can't do that on my own. I can't do that in my flesh. That's not in me, man. You do something wrong with me, to me, I don't like it. But I've learned to submit my will to the Lord and let the Lord love and carry me that extra mile, or to give my coat up, or whatever it is, or to turn the other cheek. I don't know if you have to turn it twice, but I know you got to turn it once, okay? Give to him who asks of you, and do not turn away from him who wants to borrow from you. You have heard it said that you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven, for he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Did you hear that? When you go out, when the sunshine out there, or the rain today, you can be saved or not saved. It rains on both of us. The sun shines on the evil person and the person who is not evil. God looked on both. Now, one day it will not, but for right now it does. You know, Leviticus 19, verse 18 says, "You shall not take vengeance, nor bear any grudge against the children of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." Don't get revenge. Matter of fact, the word says, "Revenge is mine, saith the Lord." Let him deal with it. He's better at it than you. All you have to do is think about all of the things that you've done to God, all of the things you've done to Jesus, and then look at whatever somebody's done to you, and he's forgiven you, you can forgive them, because you've done a lot more to Jesus than anybody's done to you. You know, Paul in Galatians, he put it this way, Galatians chapter 5, he says, "For you, brethren, have been called to liberty." In other words, in Christ we're free. You know, I'm free to come to church like this, or to put on a suit and a tie, or put a head covering on. You know, I'm free. I'm called to liberty. "Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but don't use your liberty to just indulge in the flesh." You know, in other words, you know what? I have the liberty to go have a beer, but I'm not at liberty to go get drunk. But you know what? I don't even take my liberty to have a beer to have one, because you know what? I don't want to do that and stumble anybody else. So I just don't do it. "But through love, serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself." Don't you just like that? The Ten Commandments, all the laws are fulfilled in one: love your neighbor as yourself. Love the Lord God with all heart, soul, and mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And you fulfill the law. That makes it easy. That way you don't have to get busy doing all the other stuff and being worried about doing this. If you're loving people, you won't be doing the things you have to be worried about. At least that's what I found in my life. You know, I'm standing up here, you know, teaching the word this morning. Well, that means I'm not out doing something else I shouldn't be doing, right? And the more I try to serve the Lord and do things for the Lord, the less I catch myself getting in problems, troubles. But Galatians 5:15, "If you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law." So how do you walk in the Spirit? Ask to be filled with the Spirit. And if you spend time with the Lord and you spend time in His Word, you're more than likely will have a better chance of walking in the Spirit. If you don't spend any time in His Word, you don't spend time in fellowship, probably spending more time in the flesh, you'll be walking in the flesh and fulfilling desires of the flesh. It's another spiritual thing, you know. In verse 22 of Galatians 5, it says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love." So if you're walking in the Spirit, you're going to be loving people. You'll be ministering to people. There's a commandment about this. In Ephesians 5:18, says this, "And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit." That's the one commandment about the Holy Spirit. It's something that you let happen in your life. Be filled with the Spirit. How are you filled with the Spirit? Well, 1 John 5:14 says this, "Now this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us, whatever we ask, we know we will have the petitions that we have asked for." So, if we pray something in our life that is God's will, He's going to do it. That's what that's saying. So you repent, you have faith, you turn from your sin, and in faith, ask, "Lord, fill me with your Holy Spirit." Now I say repent and turn from your sin first, because if you're full of yourself and full of your sin, there's no room for the Spirit in your life. Repent, get rid of that stuff, and let the Holy Spirit fill you. Fill you to overflowing. It's His commandment and His will for us to be filled. And then when you ask, believe. Believe that it's happened. Ask, receive, and believe. And the result of that will be love in your life. Accept others where they're at. It's a way of loving them. Because hopefully they accept you where you're at. We're all in a different place. And if you look at your life, maybe that where that person is at today, you were there at one time. And you need to have compassion for them. Maybe they're struggling with things that you struggle with in your life at one time. Don't act like you're better than others, okay? Don't envy the rich. Don't envy the famous. Enjoy God's provision in your life. You know, in Luke 12:15, Jesus said, "Take heed and beware of covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of things he possesses." And we know Matthew 6:33 says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all those things will be added unto you." He's going to take care of you. That whole chapter, he takes care of you. Just let him do that. Listen, the rich and the poor can only eat one meal at a time. That's it. There's no difference. You know, Solomon, who was one of the richest men, if not the richest man who ever lived, he did whatever he wanted. He had everything there was. Anything that you've ever coveted, anything he had. I mean, the guy had 1,000 women, right? I mean, I don't know why he want that. I don't want more than one. That one's enough, right?
Amen.
Amen. 1,000 women. Crazy. He had all the gold. Silver was nothing to him. He had everything, right? Here's what he said. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 4. He says this: "I made my works great. I built myself houses." He had all the houses he wanted, man. He had one on the Caribbean Sea here, and then he had one over in Maui, Hawaii, and then he had one in Venice, and you know. I don't know if they had those or not, but you know, you get the idea. And planted myself vineyards. Man, he had all the grapes for all the wine in the world. "I made myself gardens and orchards, and I planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made myself water pools." He had swimming pools everywhere. "From which to water the growing trees of the grove. I acquired male and female servants and had servants born in my house. Yes, I had greater possessions of herds and flocks than all who were in Jerusalem before me. I also gathered myself silver and gold and special treasures of kings and of the provinces. I acquired male and female singers." He had all the best singers, man. Tony Bennett. You guys know Tony Bennett? He left us. He had them all. I acquired male and female singers, the delights of sons of men and musical instruments of all kinds. So I became great and excelled more than all who were before me in Jerusalem. All my wisdom remained with me. Whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I did not withhold my heart from any pleasure, for my heart rejoiced in all my labor, and this is my reward for my labor. Then I looked at all the works of my hands that I had done, and all the labor which I had toiled, and indeed, all was vanity and grasping for wind. There was no profit under the sun." He had everything. And he says it's nothing. It's a hole in a donut. And not the one you eat. The one that's there you can't see. A big hole. Be satisfied with where God has you. 1 Timothy 6:6. "Now godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and it is certain we carry nothing out, and having food and clothing with this, we shall be content." So be satisfied. And don't lose sight of where the real treasures are. You see, The real treasures are in heaven. Colossians 3:1 says that if you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above and not on things of the earth. So have your focus on the things of in eternity, but not so much that you forget about everything down here. But have your heart there. That's where your treasure is. Where your treasure is where your heart is. If your treasure is in heaven, that's where your heart will be. And remember the poor. Remember the poor. When you do that, you won't be showing partiality, and you'll be keeping yourself from sin. So let me end with this. As it says there in the scripture, fulfill the royal law. Love your neighbor as yourself. Don't show partiality. Treat everyone with the same respect, no matter who they are, where they're from, and what they do. Love your enemy and be filled with the Spirit so that you can do those things. So I think what I want to do is I just want to end in prayer right now. And I'm going to pray. And I ask you to just agree with me in this prayer. That we would repent of our sin and then be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I guarantee you, if you do that, you will be filled. So Lord, we come before you right now, Lord, and you know each one of our hearts and our minds. So Lord, I pray you would search us right now, Lord. And we just want to confess to you those things in our life, Lord, that is sin, that have not been right, Lord. And ask you, by your blood, Lord, forgive us of our sin. We want to turn from it right now, Lord. We give it to you. We thank you that you died on the cross for it. And we receive that forgiveness right now, Lord. Thank you for forgiving me of my sin. Thank you for forgiving us of our sin. And then, Lord, we would ask, fill us afresh with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Fill us afresh right now. And we know in your word you say to be filled, so we're believing that it has happened, Lord, and that you've filled with your Spirit. We thank you for filling us with your Spirit. And now, Lord, since we've turned away from our sin, Lord, we've turned to you, we've been filled with your Spirit. Now, Lord, minister to others through us. Give us a love for those that we come in contact with, that they can know who you are, Lord. They can go and they would turn from their lives and turn to you and go to heaven with us, Lord. There's so many people lost in this world, Lord, that need you so badly. Use us to draw them to yourself. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word, Lord. I thank you for those who are here this morning. I pray that you would bless them this week, Lord, and use them for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing, I love you, Lord.
And I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear.
Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great week in the Lord this week.